After our video on seed oils and inflammation, a lot of viewers have asked about cardiovascular disease. Do seed oils and omega-6s affect heart disease and cardiovascular disease? So I recently sat down with Dr. Kevin Mackey. Kevin is the current president of the American National Lipid Association and the founder of MB Clinical Research and Consulting. He's published hundreds of studies and book chapters on lipid biology, including work on omega-6s, saturated fat, and cardiovascular disease. So I figured no better person to address these questions with. My goal is always to bring the top science and the top scientists on the planet straight to your electronic device. So I'm really excited to release this series of videos with Dr. Mackey. It's not just the nuggets of knowledge he shares with us. It's also getting to see how a professional scientist thinks and talks. As he answers my questions, try to notice how every statement is rooted in evidence, how cautious he is, how he qualifies everything, how he acknowledges areas of uncertainty. We live in an age of influencers yelling at you about poison and toxins and superfoods with absolute unshakable confidence and no evidence. So I think platforming more scientists is exactly what we need. Enjoy. As you might know, there's a lot of questions, a lot of curiosity by the public on the internet about omega-6s and omega-6 rich oils and all these things. And people are getting all kinds of different messages from different sources on the internet. So it'd be great if you could give a slightly summarized version of that, kind of the overview of the field. What is the evidence? And specifically with regards to cardiovascular disease, what do we know in terms of the effect of omega-6s or omega-6 rich oils on cardiovascular disease and kind of the main lines of evidence?
Sure thing. Well, there are two main lines of evidence, observational evidence and then randomized controlled trials. And for randomized controlled trials, unfortunately, we don't have modern large-scale outcomes trials for the most part. We do for a few things like a Mediterranean dietary pattern. But most of the randomized controlled trials that looked at actual outcomes like heart attacks and strokes and death were completed decades ago. And so they're difficult to interpret. So from the observational evidence, what we generally see is that a diet higher in unsaturated fatty acids, and that would be either omega-6 polyunsaturated fatty acids or omega-9 monounsaturated fatty acids, is associated with lower risk for cardiovascular disease events. And saturated fatty acid intake is associated with higher risk, but you always have to ask the question in nutrition, compared to what? And so it does depend on what you compare it to. When you compare saturated fatty acid intake to trans fats are worse. When you compare saturated fatty acid intake to unsaturated fats, saturated fats are worse. When you compare saturated fats to carbohydrates from starches, refined starches, and added sugars, they're roughly neutral. And when you compare saturated fatty acid intake to intake of carbohydrates from whole grains, the saturated fatty acids look worse. So, you know, the question is always compared to what? And then we also have randomized controlled trials to look at the effects of different fatty acids on biomarkers of disease risk. And so one of the main biomarkers that we look at is LDL cholesterol. LDL cholesterol is a surrogate marker, really, for atherogenic lipoproteins. And a better marker is apolipoprotein B, because every potentially atherogenic lipoprotein particle has one molecule of ApoB. So that's LDL particles, VLDL particles, chylomicron remnant particles, and then IDL or intermediate density lipoprotein particles and LP little a particles. So all the bad guys have one molecule of ApoB. So I like to look at that, but we don't really measure that clinically in the US. And so we use LDL cholesterol as an imperfect indicator. And so what we see is if you feed people saturated fatty acids, LDL cholesterol goes up. If you feed them monounsaturated fatty acids, LDL cholesterol goes down a little bit compared to carbohydrates or saturated fats. And if you feed them polyunsaturated fatty acids, omega-6, LDL cholesterol goes down more. So just to put that into perspective, compared to usual diet, in a controlled feeding study that we did, where we gave everybody all of their food during the study period, we found that extra virgin olive oil, which is rich in MUFAs, monounsaturated fatty acids, lowered LDL cholesterol by about 3.5%. Corn oil, which is rich in omega-6 linoleic acid, lowered LDL cholesterol by about 11%. So LDL cholesterol is a biomarker that we use to estimate risk. It's only one factor, but as far as lipoprotein levels go, as far as the observational evidence goes, and as far as the limited evidence we have from large-scale randomized controlled outcomes trials go, the real winners are unsaturated fatty acids, and that's both mono and polyunsaturated fatty acids. In our study that I mentioned, where we fed people, the lipid levels looked better with corn oil, but blood pressure and heart rate went down with extra virgin olive oil. So, you know, I'm a fan of saying that in general, in the US, we eat more saturated fat than is optimal. And we should be striving to replace some of that saturated fat with unsaturated fats. And that would be both linoleic acid or omega-6 and things like canola oil, avocado oil, olive oil that are rich in monounsaturated fatty acids.
One thing that people ask when it comes to observational data, there's a couple of caveats. And one of them is the reliance on self-report, that there can be error, there can be people may not be completely forthright, or they may not remember, things of this nature. Mm-hmm. To some extent with omega-6s and with linoleic acid in particular, there is, I understand, a sort of a way around it by measuring serum markers. To what extent is that a reliable measure of intake? And to what extent is that, what has that taught us in terms of also cardiovascular outcomes?
When it comes to biomarkers, there are certain fatty acids for which biomarkers can be very valuable. So like omega-3 fatty acid intake, when you look at things like red blood cell membranes, when you look at plasma phospholipids, even total plasma levels, they really vary a lot, specifically EPA, eicosapentaenoic acid, and DHA, docosahexaenoic acid. Dietary variation produces variation in these biomarkers. So it works really well for that. Works pretty well for linoleic acid as well, again, an omega-6 PUFA. For other fatty acids, not as well, because as an example, when humans convert carbohydrate into fat, they mainly produce palmitic acid. So the palmitic acid level in the blood reflects partly what's in the diet and partly how much de novo lipogenesis is going on. So you have some similar problems with the monounsaturated fatty acids. So again, it depends on what you're looking at, but you do get around this issue specifically with linoleic acid and EPA and DHA of uncertainty because dietary measurements are very crude. You know, if I ask you over the last 3 months, how many times did you eat this? You know, you're going to give an estimate, but who knows how accurate it is. And so for huge groups of people, it works reasonably well. For smaller groups, there's a lot of imprecision. And so biomarkers are very helpful because they can help us quantify the exposure to these levels of fatty acids. And then there are genetic variants that also influence the biomarker levels and so forth. So, you know, they're not perfect tools, but they are very helpful. And for the most part, when it comes to the omega-6 polyunsaturated fatty acids, the biomarker results really align very well with the results from dietary estimation. And so they tell a pretty consistent story. Lower risk of cardiovascular disease associated with higher intake of omega-6 and omega-3 polyunsaturated fatty acids. My conclusion is that the bulk of the evidence, which has limitations, supports the idea that we should be consuming more unsaturated fatty acids and try and replace saturated fatty acids with unsaturated fatty acids from both omega-6 PUFAs and omega-9 MUFAs.
And you know, what about omega-3s? Are you leaving those out for a reason or?
Not leaving them out for a reason. I think that we have some pretty good evidence now, and it comes from a number of sources, that EPA in particular is helpful. When it comes to cardiovascular disease risk, we have three studies. None of them are perfect, but we have the REDUCE-IT trial, we have the JELIS trial, and then we recently just saw results from RESPECT EPA, another study done in Japan like JELIS. And all three of them have essentially shown the same thing: reduce cardiovascular disease event risk when EPA is given. And it has to be at a decent dose. Two of the trials used 1.8 grams a day, one used 4 grams a day. And all three of them showed basically concordant results, sort of 20 to 25% reduction in cardiovascular disease events. RESPECT EPA for the primary outcome had a p-value of 0.055. So, you know, taken in conjunction with JELIS, I think two trials in Japan with essentially the same intervention have shown benefit. And then in the REDUCE-IT trial, which was 4 grams a day of EPA, or very close to 4 grams a day, about 3.8 grams, that trial showed about a 25% reduction in the primary outcome, which was cardiovascular disease events. The one fly in the ointment there is that the placebo that was used was mineral oil. And we have some evidence that mineral oil makes some cardiovascular risk factors worse. And so what I would say is it is possible that some portion of that 25% was due to the adverse effects of the mineral oil on outcomes. But when you, let's attribute 5% to that. That means we have three trials that have all shown roughly 20% risk reduction with an EPA intervention. One of the things that taking EPA does is it suppresses blood levels of arachidonic acid. So one possible contributing mechanism is not only the benefits of EPA, but the benefit that may result from reducing blood levels of arachidonic acid.
There are a couple of common questions in this area that people ask when they hear this idea that unsaturated fats are more health promoting or more cardioprotective. The main one is probably regarding a couple of specific randomized controlled trials from the 60s and 70s, Minnesota and Sydney. This is probably question number one. What do we know about these trials? And are there caveats? Are they, how reliable are they? What do they teach us?
Well, I think a lot of caveats, and you know, kudos to Chris Ramsden and Joe Hiblin for going back and unearthing more information about these trials so that they could really be considered. But there's only so much you can do when a trial was conducted decades ago and you're sort of forensically trying to reconstruct what was done. Also, the outcome that was really focused on was cardiovascular mortality as well as total mortality. And, you know, that's a complicated outcome. So some of cardiovascular mortality is due to events, heart attacks, and some is due to heart attacks and strokes on the one hand, some is due to arrhythmias. Sometimes it's difficult to classify. So in modern trials, if you look at all of the myocardial infarctions that are submitted to adjudication committees, very often 20% of them are rejected. And the conclusion of the committee that's reviewing it is, we can't tell for sure that this is a myocardial infarction. So I think that looking at trials from decades ago is problematic, both in terms of assessing the outcomes and also because people were very different then, much higher prevalence of smoking. And years ago, the diet was very different. It was very common to have something like 16% of your calories from saturated fatty acids. back then as compared to about 11% today. So the people were different in many respects, lifestyle-wise and in their characteristics, and the assessment of outcomes was different than it would be in a modern trial. So I think they tell us some things, but we have to be very careful about over-interpreting them. And so what I'll say is that for those studies, the conclusion was essentially that the studies did not support a benefit of replacing saturated fatty acids with unsaturated fatty acids, with a couple of caveats. One issue that's been raised is the possibility that the unsaturated fatty acids came along with some trans fatty acids. And we can't tell. I mean, you can't go back decades and say, well, we're going to go to the storage unit and take some of the, intervention foods and test them. So all you can do is look at the records and try and assess whether that was true. I think it's uncertain. And so I view those in the same way I view a lot of observational evidence. They're reasonable for hypothesis generation, and we really need to test these ideas in large-scale randomized controlled outcomes trials. And I'm sad to say that, Spain is way ahead of us in funding those. It's kind of an embarrassment that the United States has not funded these trials, even though every 5 years we update our dietary recommendations. We don't follow that up with large-scale trials to test them.
One specific argument or question I've heard regarding Sydney is that this likelihood of the trans fats is not very believable because the level of total cholesterol, serum cholesterol, or LDL cholesterol, I forget which one they measured, came down by 20 points or so. And so the argument is that if they were replacing, if the comparator was trans fats, you would expect an increase in total cholesterol. To what extent is that a valid argument?
Yeah, well, you have these competing effects. So you have the influence of the unsaturated fatty acids, and even if some trans fatty acids came along with it, you've got unsaturated fatty acids lowering LDL cholesterol. Trans fatty acids would tend to have the opposite effect. And so the net would depend on the ratio of unsaturated to trans unsaturated fatty acids. And so, that does bolster the argument that it was mainly unsaturated PUFAs that were being given. But, trans fats have a very strong and linear relationship to cardiovascular risk that's probably partly mediated through effects on lipids, but partly mediated through other effects. So, again, it is just another one of the question marks we have about these trials. And why I am hopeful that we'll see new trials undertaken. But one thing that I think may help with that is that outcomes trials are very large and expensive, and they take a long time to generate enough events. But we now have imaging technologies where you can have much smaller studies and look at a much better surrogate marker than just lipid levels or blood pressure and what have you, and look at the actual progression of atherosclerosis. And you can do that non-invasively now. And with new AI technologies, we're getting much, much better at reading those and detecting small changes. So I'm hopeful that we'll have dietary intervention trials where, they don't have to last for 10 years. They can last for a couple of years of follow-up, and we'll have very reliable evidence about progression of atherosclerosis, which doesn't tell the full story, but it certainly tells a big portion of the story. So I'm optimistic we'll have that. It's not going to be in the next couple of years, but hopefully before I die of natural causes.
Hopefully, long before we're all gone. We also discussed the effect of seed oils on inflammation, insulin resistance, body weight, the omega-3 to omega-6 ratio, and a lot of other topics. So stay tuned for those videos dropping as soon as we can finalize them. Thanks for watching. Take care. Let me know your questions below. I'll catch you next week.